Mr. Raman and ARC Advisory Group for giving me this opportunity. So my earlier speakers have covered whatever all I wanted to, my expectations are there. So just I have to recap and excuse me if there is any repetition. So just I'll be talking on the requirements for the offshore drilling. Normally everybody knows about the chemical industry, process, what are all the various requirements well known to industry. The offshore drilling rigs are located remotely, access is not there for everybody, and people are not knowing what are all our requirements. Presently, only local indications, local controls are there, and particularly from the vendor side also, very limited vendors are there. So the total instrumentation system on the offshore drilling floaters, rigs, it is a very at infant stage. So we expect more vendors to come forward to help the industry so that performance can be, drilling performance can be improved upon. Just agenda, just introduction, the type of rigs, just I'm going to talk. What are all the parameters we are wanted to monitor, that the safety of the rigs, that what are all the various challenges. Then the introduction of this wireless technology already spoke by the other earlier speakers. Rest of the things also mostly covered, but just I will recap. This oil and gas sector, it is now spread all over offshore and onshore. The onshore locations are located at the remote locations. Offshore, biggest constraint is the space constraint. So the rigs are very confined place, it is there. It has to accommodate approximately 100 and odd people who are working on the rigs. And it has to power generators, pumps, and drilling equipment. There's a very, space is very, very scarce there. So we want the miniaturized equipment for this particular applications. The conventional things may not suit our requirement. That is the biggest challenge. Then in the land and other things, any retro modifications are very easy. We can change it and go for the new things. Whereas offshore, it becomes a certain mandatory regulations are there. It becomes very difficult to change the equipment, replacement of the cables, really Herculean task. So for that, everything is a miniaturized systems are required for us. Only, as I already told you, players are very, very limited in this. The competition is not there, so we don't get the proper vendors for this. Just I will say what are all the, I suppose most of, if anybody is not knowing, just I will brief the, what are all the type of rigs we are handling. This is the jack-up rig. Normally the hull moves up and down. It, at the time of drilling, the hull will be jacking up, then we do the drilling operation. Once the drilling operation is over, then hull will be again down to water. Then it will be sailed to new location, tow to, with the help of any tow, we have to go to the new location. Again there we have to jack up and do the drilling operation. The water clearance there, it is there approximately we maintain water depth 100 meters we deploy the offshore, this jack-up rigs. Drilling depth from the bed, seabed, it will be approximately 3 kilometers we'll be drilling, horizontal wells and vertical wells. The adjacent one is showing the one platform, then adjacent is the jack-up rig. This is also one more jack-up rig. These are all the drill ships. One is a submersible, another is the floater. They are the self-propelled. They can go to any place, what we wanted there. But present operations, we are operating up to 300 meters of water depth. Certain things are available, even up to 300 meters of water depth also, these drill ships are available, but we are going up to 1,000 meter water depth as on date. This is a submersible rig. These rigs have been just classified as various generations, first to fifth generation, based on the water depth and the date of manufacture. That now the present sixth generation rig, they are introducing the automation. Advanced technology is being introduced, but whereas that other fourth generation, first to fourth, now these are all 25 to 30 years old rigs. So there we are facing the problems because the equipment has become old. We have to add a new equipment, new sensors, new things. So that is creating the problem and the players are not available. For the new things, yes, shipyards are available and people are doing well. So these are all the various parameters we monitor on the rig. Most of the things are known. Certain things, one is the ballast control. The rig, whenever it is there in the water, that is to be balanced. There are various tanks are there that fluid to be shifted from the one tank to another tank. It is a potable water, drill water, diesel, any other chemicals. It has to be transferred from the one tank to another tank for the dynamic balancing of the rigs. So for that, valves are there, hydraulically operated valves. So there also we are in need of the industry support, because the vessels have become around 25 years old. We have to change the total ballast control systems for that replacement of the valves and the control systems. The latest technology, PLC, we can use it if the player come forward. So we are happy to accept it. So other things are very known parameters only. Another is that engine control monitoring, that emission controls, at least we can see what is the performance of the engines. That also we have to monitor. For three rigs, we already started the job for doing all these around 350 parameters for monitoring. We already placed order and our execution is going on. So depend upon the lessons learned and the successfulness of that project, we are planning to take up the future rigs also. As on date, there are 40 offshore rigs, are just for the information of gathering here, around 40 rigs are working. So huge market potential is there in India itself. This is the BOP blowout preventer. So this is used to control the undesired activity in the wells. So this also, presently, the local indication, local controls are there. So here also automation is very much needed in case of any emergency. People cannot approach the things from the remote location if it can be controlled. So it will save the equipment, life, and the environment. So I already told you, space constraint to avoid the overcome the things, what are all the things we are looking for, that it has been mentioned here. So most of the things my previous speakers have already covered. That equipment should be very miniaturized. That elimination of the cables again, it adds to weight. At the same time, laying the cable also very difficult. So we are looking for this wireless technology. Even the conventional, instead of conventional servers and workstations, we see the single board computers, then all-in-one PCs available, then thin clients, then Mr. Raman has already shown us that even why can't we use the smartphones? So if the architecture is open, definitely we can go for the, anybody can see to it through Wi-Fi and web-enabled services, people can see the data. Whatever is I'm interested, I can see. I need not have the entire plant. My jurisdiction is the particular section. I can very well monitor my cell phone or my tablet or iPhone. I should be able to do it. So present scenario, what is there? The people supply some software. They say that it works on a brand computer only. I have to purchase again that A brand only. B brand, C brand, no, it won't work. So that is the situation. So for that, that open architecture is required. Then again, long battery life. Again, same thing, I think is the repetition. So. These sensors, what is the problem now? Certain statutory requirements are there. These are to be calibrated once in a year. Okay, land, no problem. People can go there and calibrate it. Whereas in the offshore, even going itself is one person going, one trip will cost one lakh rupees. So as per statutory, just a small pressure gauge to be calibrated. First thing, reliability. The manufacturer should say that, okay, my equipment, you need not calibrate for the 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, it works. And it should have the self-diagnostic feature. It should be able to, some mechanism, it should, the health of that equipment, we should be able to monitor. By seeing that particular certain parameters, we should say that, yes, now it is okay, it need not be removed from the site and calibrated. If such things are available, we can save a lot of manpower and money to the country. That again, that frequency calibration I told you, so why at all it should be 1 year, why not 2, 3, 4, 5, or even more? Or it should tell, yes, now you replace me. Or calibrate. So such things are available, self-diagnostic, then it will. That open architecture, of course, we already discussed. That multi-vendor interchangeability. So people should not say that only you have to purchase the particular equipment from the particular vendor only. Why not that interchangeability? If it is there, it will be, normally customer will be happy. So adjacent one PC is available, but I cannot use it. I have to go for some other specific PC only. So that is a problem. that wireless technology, even for the heat, smoke, plug and play sensors, will help the customer a lot. Normally, we are unmanned operations, even going to one place to another place through choppers and other things. Particularly, I'm concentrating only in the offshore operations. So it is very costly affair. So systems, sensors, everything should be unmanned. If it is available, it should be maintenance-free systems. It is very much useful. So just I was asked to talk just on the shale gas. Just I have collected some information. Is it the next source of energy for the India? I think at the moment for India, it is answer is no. But whereas rest of the world, people are concentrating on the shale gas, particularly in the USA, a lot of things are going on. In India, I think even one of the important players also withdrawn from the shale gas exploration. I think immediately there may not be much scope for the, at least next few years. Just this is the various, that gray areas where this shale gases are available all over the world. Then what are all the various that natural gas resources? One is the coal bed methane, that is the very at the shallow depth it is available. For this exploration is going on at Madhya Pradesh and the Bokaro. Some three or four companies in India, they are exploring the coal bed methane, but not big breakthrough has been made so far. Then another is the conventional non-associated gas. It is a free gas in the KG basin. These free gases are available. Another is the associated gas, where oil and gas together is available. When we extract the oil, along with the oil, gas will come. That gas will be liberated. That is the associated gas. Then another is the shale gas. It is very difficult to extract. The permeability is very high. So the technologies are not available at the moment. Of course, in USA, they are doing it. But recently, you might have seen in the last 3-4 days paper, it has come. France has totally banned exploration of the shale gas because of the pollution, groundwater pollution, soil pollution, air pollution, so totally banned the shale gas exploration. So these are all the various challenges. But first and foremost is the government regulation. If anybody is drilling for the oil and gas, if the shale gas is encountered, you are not supposed to extract it. It is the property of the government. Without license, nobody can go for the shale gas. So that is the one of the biggest problems as on date. Even if somebody encounters, they ignore it. They don't bother for the thing. That exploration policy, only conventional gas, they cannot go for the shale gas. That is a big problem. It is economically uneconomical because of the lack of technology as on date. Over a period of time, it may come. Not in India, but elsewhere, they have observed huge shale gas reserves are available. Over a period of time, I think people may go, this is the conventional things are exhausted. Naturally, there is no other go but to go for the shale gas. So this is, of course, not in our hands. It is the government of India has to take a decision for amending the regulations. That again, first second point is also related with the first point. If they can allow the companies to go for shale gas exploration along with the conventional, so people can do it, so it becomes economical. So this is one more thing. This is the digital oil fields. I think it is a repetition only. Whatever is the data available at the various pockets, is the production, drilling, transportation, consumption, and other thing, all the information data can be pulled at a single place for taking the informed decisions. Because the exploration is going on various places, onshore, offshore, even various other countries also, foreign countries also. So at a single point, if somebody has to take proper decisions, any complexity is there at Uganda, so from here you have to take a decision, means information is required. So all these comes under this digital oil field. If the total information is pulled up at a single place, the operator can take a timely informed decision. So these are all the various reasons I've been elaborated why at all that oil field, intelligent digital oil field is required. Another thing, normally this particular industry is the knowledge driven and people are becoming aged and retiring, so that knowledge transfer is not taking place. If at all this digital information is pulled up, even people can take the informed decisions. Thank you. Anything, any questions, please?